Welcome and thank you for joining us for Beaverton Now. I'm your host, Margy Lynch. Beaverton is seeing a lot of success and progress right now. Two very important things that we want to tell you about today, great strides and accomplishments in protecting our environment, and that has earned the city some national recognition. And also, Beaverton is putting a lot of effort into keeping residents and the city safe, which has led to some research and studying on how to handle critical space and safety needs within the police, courts, and emergency preparedness. Joining me now is Beaverton Mayor Denny Doyle. Thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
I think people know that, you know, Beaverton is such a safe city that it's hard for them to imagine that there are some needs with space for the police and courts.
Sure. Well, we do have an outstanding police force with a great reputation, and they earn it every year. What people may not know, and that was a really good question, is that the space needs have been completely overshadowed by the human factor inside a city hall. Back in 1986, when the building was bought, it was expected to be a 5 to 10 year fix. Mm. When we moved in, Mayor Cole and City Council were of the mind to do something within that time frame. Here we are, 26 years later.
A long time overdue. The growth is pretty incredible, right, as you mentioned, and with 64 employees going to 174 now, working in that same tight space, you wonder how they can do it.
Well, it's about based on studies, it's about one third of the need that this size of department should have. We actually have to lease two big buildings to house evidence and training, and that's a huge expense that we really shouldn't be you know, laying out every year.
Right, and that's outside of City Hall.
Exactly,
right?
Outside of City Hall.
Okay.
So, you know, as you mentioned, we were at 64 personnel. Now we're at about 174. So almost triple since they moved into that building.
And so obviously important to take a look at this. I know that there's a lot of space issues right there with municipal courts. Some people don't know, and I didn't until I went in there and took a tour, but that they're sharing some space with people going to pay tickets, serving jury duty.
Right. It's a big issue in terms of safety. You may be standing in line to pay your ticket with a much more serious offender, and that's not a healthy thing. The washrooms are shared with staff, including the judges, and anybody who's there to have their day in court.
And we saw that firsthand, actually. Lieutenant Paul Wendell with the police department gave us a tour, and let's have you take a look.
Main security and space needs problem we have is we have only one way to bring prisoners from the holding facility, the police department, down to muni court and for appearances with the judge. So there's only one way, and as we bring prisoners down the hallway, we're mixing right in with citizens of the community who are here to either speak with the court or to pay a fine. So there's a lot of problems with mixing prisoners and the general public, but that's the only option we have right now.
And Lieutenant Wendell was also showing us a few more areas there, like the prisoner intake area that has prisoners coming in and being booked right where police officers, it's within arm's reach of where they're doing their police reports. So it can be a real distraction for them.
And I'm sure the video, you could see how crowded the conditions are for storing equipment, storing clothes. When the women officers come in to change, they have to move stuff out of their way to get to the locker and put it in the shower room and bring it back.
And I saw the men's locker room was also definitely crowded.
Yep.
Just a real crowding issue, definitely with this equipment storage. I understand, though, the space issue doesn't only impact the police and courts, it also impacts city services.
It's throughout the whole building. Right now, we are literally out of rooms. We've converted conference rooms to small cubicles. We have people sharing desks. We've had to put a glass partition up in the front lobby. And that is where crime victims are interviewed by the police officers, right next to the front door of City Hall.
And I saw that area we're talking about when I was on a recent tour there. And I also spoke with Shelley Oliver, who is a crime victims advocate. Here's what she had to say. And Shelley, thank you very much for being here. And you work with crime victims in your role. What kind of emotional state are they in? And tell us, what needs do they have when they come to you?
Well, the interesting thing about working with crime victims is it doesn't always matter what category or crime. There is always some level of traumatization associated with any kind of crime. And so many of the clients that we see at the Domestic Violence Resource that are needing additional support to kind of understand what the process is and what their rights are. And I think anyone who works as an advocate in any part of the system, the judicial system, or out in the community advocating for their clients really understands that clients need ongoing support. And someone who can kind of help them navigate the process.
Talk a little bit about their nerves. I mean, mm-hmm. they're probably a little bit fragile when they come in and have been through this experience. So talk about, you know, how they're feeling that way.
Well, many of them experience a level of traumatization, and that can be extremely devastating when you have never been a victim of crime before. That in itself is very difficult, because sometimes we like to believe that the system is very sensitive to victims, but unfortunately, they serve a purpose, and a lot of times their emotional needs go relatively unmet, not at any fault of anyone who works in law enforcement or mm-hmm. the judicial branch, but everybody has a role. And so as an advocate, we do try to sort of fill the gap where maybe the system can't, because there are emotional needs associated with experiencing a victimization.
Okay. And when you see the space that victims are interviewed in the Beaverton City Hall here by the police department, what do you think the experience would be like for that? I know that I saw, you know, there's glass windows and not a lot of room. What would that be like for a victim?
I think it would be at the very least uncomfortable, because many times crime victims are talking about experiences that they've never talked about before that are very personal and very sensitive. And where that cubicle is located in the office or downstairs is very public. And so there's not a lot of privacy. And so a lot of folks are disclosing information that they wouldn't otherwise really feel comfortable doing out in the open. And it appears that that is a very open area to kind of talk about things that maybe already have a lot of emotional impact. And people kind of get to observe that as they walk through.
And that definitely could affect the way they are reporting it and maybe how they feel. And I think you kind of mentioned this, re-victimizing them or making them...
Yes, yes. And unfortunately, that happens sometimes with the process, and why, you know, it doesn't always appear very sensitive, because sometimes the process in which victims have to come forward can be re-traumatizing, and it's like reliving their victimization.
What is the best case scenario when somebody is going to go in and talk to someone, you know, when they're going to report their crime? I mean, privacy, it sounds like, is obviously important.
Oh, I would think that was very critical, is to have a place where they can go, where they can feel some comfort and have some level of emotional safety in knowing in that the information that they're disclosing is going to remain private as possible. In an area that they have in Beaverton City Hall, unfortunately, that isn't one of the more, I would say, client-centered or victim-centered kind of places to have for victims to share that kind of information.
And just in general, that space and the interviewing space, are you surprised when you see that? Or, I mean, is it, compared to other places that you see, is it normal, is it common, or is it surprising to you?
The truth be told, I've lived in Washington County for the last 15 years, and I've had experiences working with a lot of different departments, and I was not aware, and I was a little surprised by that, because I know that Beaverton is a very progressive city, and so I was kind of shocked to hear that we have victims being interviewed right in the main lobby and the municipal court, people coming and going, and no separate real place for people to find comfort when they're preparing to go in front of a judge and such. So it's very surprising to me.
Yeah. And we're now joined by Beaverton's Police Chief Jeff Spaulding to share with us his views on the space subject. And welcome. Thanks for being here.
Thank you, Margie.
And tell us, what are your concerns? Your officers continue to do their job with even these tight circumstances.
Well, I think the part of the problem is that we do provide such a high level of service to the public, and the public recognizes that, and they appreciate the level of service we do. But what the public doesn't realize is that the conditions that the men and women of the Beaverton Police Department are working on in the tight, crowded conditions, the mayor alluded to that earlier, working out of about a third of our space. But what the public sees is the response from the officers in the field, and that's their only understanding of, you know, the space that the officers need. But that's not entirely accurate, because the patrol function only makes up about a third of our entire workforce.
And so they're seeing the officers out on the street. Tell us your top concerns.
Well, I have many concerns. One, of course, is that over the period of the last 25 years, as the mayor alluded to also earlier, that we've grown into this very small space, and it's created some pretty significant inefficiencies. And as a result of that, you know, it doesn't allow us to do as good a job as I think we could do. One example is that we have two separate facilities off-site. One's our property and evidence, and the other is our training building and our professional standards. My goal is to get these men and women back all under the same roof, to have the security issues addressed, such as our property and evidence building, and have those all back under one building. And by doing that, it increases our security. It provides a higher level of efficiency. The other big concern, of course, is our essential facilities requirement. There's a requirement by state law that requires hospitals, police stations, fire stations to be built to a higher level of standard than even your most highest earthquake standards. And as a result of that, these buildings in a catastrophic event such as an earthquake are required to remain standing so that we are able to provide a high level of service to the public in these types of events. One of the things we plan to do is move our emergency management segment into the building also, because right now they're also in a separate thing, so they would also be available to respond to the public. So this is something we really feel that we need to address in order to be available, you know, when we have this event, which by some experts predict it's a 1 in 3 chance in the next couple decades that we could have a significant earthquake.
I would imagine that is a little daunting, and just the fact that the conditions your officers are working under, when you see on that video on the tour some of the conditions that they're working under.
It is, and I really do have to applaud the men and women of the Beaverton Police Department, because they really have done a very high quality job providing that level of service to the public, even in spite of the conditions that they're working in.
And when you talk about the intake room a little bit, the officers are dealing with prisoners coming in. That can be distracting, I'm sure, some security issues there for you as chief?
Correct, and it's more of a security issue. There is a distraction piece of it, but they're all in one room. The police officers do spend a fair amount of time writing police reports, booking their evidence, and in that same room, basically, there's a couple of holding cells, there's a juvenile cell, and then there's a restraint chair, which is used to restrain oftentimes violent offenders, and it's not in the best interest of our security to have all these housed in one particular location. Ideally, these would all be in an entirely separate room. You have a separate, you know, holding facility, be separate from the report room, and the security would be much tighter. Mm.
Okay, well, thank you very much, Chief. And I know that it was important for the city to cover every square inch of this issue and to get an unbiased opinion. So, Mayor, you formed a group of citizens to look into it?
Yes, a little more than a year ago, I appointed a Public Safety Center Advisory Committee, say that fast 5 times, to help advise the city on how to move forward and address these extremely important issues.
And we had a chance to talk to the chair of that committee.
Good.
Jim McCright. So let's hear what he had to say. And Jim, thank you very much for being here. Tell us a little bit about how this advisory committee was formed and why.
Well, the advisory committee was called the Public Safety Facilities Advisory Committee, which was formed by the mayor and the police chief about a year and a half ago to look into the space needs of the police and courts system here in the City Hall in Beaverton. And we pulled together 15 community leaders and began meeting a year and a half ago, and have recently come to some conclusions about what the needs are for the city in that area.
Now, it sounds like you're a guy who's definitely involved, and you've been around the city and how it operates quite a bit. So you probably saw for yourself, did you in the beginning, the space issue or the space needs, or was it something that you were surprised by the findings?
I think the whole committee was probably surprised by the degree of the need. Like most citizens and taxpayers, we weren't aware that the city had moved the police into this building in 1986 as a temporary housing situation. Here they are 25 years later, still here, and they outgrew the space several years ago, and in fact now have to rent private space outside the City Hall building in order to accommodate both their evidence storage and their training center. So they've already outgrown the space, and then when the committee had a tour of the back office, so to speak, of the police department, we were frankly really surprised about how cramped the quarters are, the storage facilities, the locker rooms for the men and women police force. It's just a situation which just wasn't satisfactory, and the committee quickly recognized that there really is a legitimate need for more space.
Now, do you come up with a specific recommendation then of what to do next, or do you, how does that work?
Well, the committee, when it first met, we decided to form three subcommittees. One was on site analysis of potential sites around the city of Beaverton where we might locate a new facility. Secondly, we also looked at the method of financing an expansion of the current facility. And thirdly, we had a committee look at the actual proposed design of a prospective new building, if a new building were to be built. So we actually looked into all three of those areas and have recently come up with some recommendations.
Okay, and to go back a little bit, first of all, what surprised you most, I guess? What do you think was the biggest critical need?
Well, I think what we were most surprised at was, first of all, that we are renting two other private spaces outside the city hall, because the police just don't have enough space within this building. The force has more than doubled since they first moved in temporarily 25 years ago. So there was a clear need for more space. There's more personnel, more equipment. And we also looked at the court situation. As many people are aware, the municipal court here in the city hall has been so busy that frankly it's had to use now the city council chambers part of the week to hold their court hearings. Mm-hmm. And the security issues are serious here in terms of the court situation. If people have been here during a court session, they see people lined up and down the hallway waiting to get in. Defendants and judges and prosecutors all are mixing together in a very narrow hallway. It's a serious security issue, and they clearly need more space as well. So that's why we think the police and the courts facility needs to be together in the same building, but probably outside this particular building.
What would you say to the people who, like you were at the beginning, who aren't aware of this, but see the police department operating so great and know that their city is safe, who might say, why change things now? Why change the building if they're working so great?
Well, that's a legitimate point, that the city does have a very good record with not only public safety, but the quality of the police department. And we are the safest city above 75,000 people in the Northwest. But that still doesn't distract from the fact that the working conditions, the efficiencies are not what they should be for a department of this size. And for example, when evidence is needed to be looked at by perhaps a defense attorney, they have to send someone over a mile away to go to the storage facility, obtain the evidence, come back. It takes much more time, takes more personnel. Just from an operating efficiency standpoint, it's just really not satisfactory. But we do need to get the story out to the public that there is a need for more space, that they've been in this temporary space for 25 years. They're renting private space that we should have within a municipal building. And we have a job to do to explain that to the public and hopefully build a case for public support to fund a new facility.
Because even though safe, maybe it could all operate more efficiently, it sounds
Correct.
Like. Okay, and so what will your recommendation, maybe not all the specific details, but what will the recommendation be?
Well, there's several options really that we could look at. The feeling is at this point that remodeling the present City Hall building, it probably is not a satisfactory solution. It oftentimes would cost more to remodel than to build a new facility, particularly for police and courts. The police are an essential service that has to meet very high building standards to be secure. If there, for example, were an earthquake, you don't want the police station collapsing in the earthquake. They're the first responders to an emergency, so the building has to be particularly well built to withstand the most severe emergencies. So remodeling is not an option. It is possible that if one of the discussions is possibly moving the City Hall facility over to the South Office Building at the Round, which the city has purchased, but that decision hasn't been made yet. But if they do move the City Hall over there, then that would open up the opportunity here to redevelop the Griffith Park site where the present City Hall is located. And we have looked at other private property sites around Beaverton. And of course the challenge there is that property values in Beaverton are very expensive, particularly commercial lots. Mm-hmm. And there's a limited number of vacant lots. So if we bought a commercial lot, it had to be we had to tear down a building on the lot, and then that just increases the overall cost.
All
so
right.
We have identified, we started out with about 18 sites we looked at. We've narrowed it down to 4 or 5 that have potential, but we are at this point, I think, waiting for the city council and the mayor to decide what the future might be for City Hall itself.
Okay, so but it was the committee's understanding and findings that staying as is not really an option.
No, that's not going to work. The city is continuing to grow. The police and courts department are continuing to grow. They're already have exceeded the physical limits of this space, so something has to be done. If City Hall stays here in the Griffith Park site, then we would propose finding a vacant lot or a lot that could be redeveloped to build a courts and police facility somewhere in the central core area.
Okay, and Beaverton's always a city that's looking to be better. So how do you think, and you're so involved, but for people, you know, the average citizen and people just, how are they how is life going to be improved for people in Beaverton, and how will Beaverton be better once this is all done and the situation is taken care of?
Right. Well, I think several benefits. One certainly is the increased efficiency and productivity from the police department personnel themselves. About a third of them, they're out on patrol in cars and motorcycles, and that's what the public sees. But a large part of the staff are internal administrative detectives, investigators, etc. So they need, you know, proper working conditions to do their work. People that come to court, perhaps they get a photo radar ticket or some other charge that brings them into the municipal court. They certainly need to feel they're coming into a secure facility and have adequate service as well. So I think the public would see that very quickly, that a new improved layout for the courts would definitely be a benefit to everyone.
Okay, and it sounds like you put a lot of time into this. You said about a year and a half you
right.
all worked on
mm-hmm.
it?
Yeah, and we've, in our committee, in the site analysis committee, also looked at other police stations here in the state that have been recently built to get some ideas about how the building could be structured and design-wise, and whether it should or shouldn't be a part of City Hall, and a lot of work has gone into it, and I think we're anxious to see a decision made by the mayor and the city council to move forward in one direction or another.
And definitely a lot of good hard work by that committee. What are the next steps?
Well, one thing is absolutely for sure. We can't sit around and wait another 26 years passing the problem on to the next generation. We are currently having conversations with our city councilors on how to proceed. We'll have a series of conversations to share all the reports and studies that have been done to date. And we really owe a tremendous thank you to Jim McCright and the committee for all the hard work they've done over the years. This is over 12 months of work. The bottom line is simply, we know we need a public safety building that is safe and secure and designed to serve its purpose. We've got studies, we know where to go with this. We need to treat our victims of crime with dignity. You've not lived until you hear, watch, and listen to a person breaking down in front of that glass. It's just painful. We need a building that will meet the seismic criteria now, and we don't want to violate the state law anymore. In a new building, we can't. We also need to know that when we need our first responders, the building's there, the backup generator is on, and they're going to work. I really believe the time has come to take a serious look at building a standalone public safety facility. It's a building that will serve as the headquarters for police, court, and emergency management, and that'll be exciting to have the whole team right there ready to help us when we, in the middle of the night, gonna need it. So Beaverton residents can expect a really thorough discussion over the coming months about what we need to do, and I think we're gonna make a real good decision. Got a beat. We're charging.
Doing some good things for the environment right there. And Beaverton has had great accomplishments in the way of protecting the environment, recently getting national recognition. Congratulations.
Well, thank you. Staff worked really hard. This is, you know, it's an overall effort throughout the city.
And this was a like competition of about 100 cities
yes.
or something by the U.S. Conference of Mayors.
Right.
Tell us, how did you achieve this award?
Well, I'll try to be brief, but some examples would be upgrading 755 of our streetlights to LEDs or induction lighting. These upgrades have taken place in residential areas, pedestrian paths, parking lots, traffic signals throughout the city. We added a 17.6 kilowatt hour solar system on top of the library. reduce carbon emissions by 18,000 tons, pounds rather, and save an estimated $6,700 every year, more than paying for itself fairly quickly. We retrofitted the lights in City Hall, the library, the resource center, the community center, and over in Public Works, saving them 108,000 kilowatt hours and more than $17,500 annually. We're replacing trash receptacles with solar powered ones. They're kind of fun to watch, and they're empty less often, very little air pollution, no carbon dioxide emissions. We're supporting recycling programs for home, work, and at school. Planted over 3,700 trees last year, again removing some carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, so they're helping us there. We added 5 electric charging stations throughout the city, one of which is powered by solar power over by the library. And it's just been fantastic to watch staff catch fire and get good feedback from the rest of the country.
And no small task then. It's taken a lot of work, and obviously you didn't do all of those steps for an award.
No.
Why is it important to make all those changes?
Well, it's something that I've always felt we needed to do to run the city more efficiently. And if you can treat the environment better, and we can show to our fellow partners or the business community that we're shaping Beaverton into a real sustainable community, we're weaving this into the budget, we're excited about it, and it's passionate throughout the building at all our different locations. And to me, that says something all itself, a great workforce that we have.
And thank you so much for joining us at home, Mayor. Thanks for being here.
It's been a lot of fun, as always.
It's been a lot of fun, and have a great day, and go out and enjoy Beaverton.